We are blessed, yes? I'm blessed to be with you. Hey, another round. So we're taking on an ambitious undertaking here with talking about evolution and the evolution of consciousness. It's a 14 billion year story, and we covered the first 13.9 billion last week. Only because you guys are such quick studies that we just zoomed right through that in 25 minutes. We covered the evolution for the first 13.9 billion. So I just thought we'd just pick it up today. It's a bit of a reminder because you may not remember 100,000 years ago. Some of you will, but not all of you. When we became Homo sapien sapiens, Homo sapien sapiens, which not just wise men, but wise men, which essentially says that you understand that you understand, or you know that you know. And I mentioned Barbara Marx Hubbard, who coined this word of Homo universalis, or the universal human, the universal human. And I just want to read this again. I just think it's so beautiful. And it's sort of a clarion call to what's possible for us as we evolve now. And I'll say a little bit more about sort of the biological evolution, which seems to be on hold for reasons that will be obvious. But she says, we are the crossover generation from one phase of evolution to the next. Although barely perceptible, as were the earliest humans in the pre-human world, a young Homo universalis is emerging everywhere, in every culture, faith, and background. The signs of our emergence as universal humans include an unconditional love for the whole of life, a powerful, irresistible passion to unite with spirit within, and a deep, heartfelt impulse to connect with others and to co-create a world equal to our love and our capacities. Isn't that just exquisite? It's just such a call of what's possible, particularly if we see that not just as some idealized notion of what the ultimate human could become, but to recognize that it's already in some sense established in us as we are created as spiritual beings. And this that she describes, which sounds lofty and in some sense of being in the future, some highly evolved beyond where we are right now, it's really only describing what it would be if we were simply to awaken to who and what we truly are, how we were created in the image and likeness of God. That's what makes this so compelling, is because in so many visions that seem so out of reach that we kind of feel like, oh yeah, that sounds lovely, but how realistic is that? But what could be more realistic than you realizing who you are? Yes. And lastly, she says, as we pass through our crises, as we successfully birth ourselves into a more universal humanity, we will emerge capable of co-evolving with nature and co-creating with spirit. We will be able to co-create a new world. During these times, it's important to stabilize our consciousness as universal humans. And we can do this by engaging in authentic relationship with others of similar intent, like we're doing here, in a collective field of resonance that can support our conscious evolution by staying awake together. Staying awake together. And that's really what I think, you know, the calling of every spiritual community is to wake up together, is to awaken together. The possibility, as Jesus said, when two or more are gathered, there I am in the midst of you. This notion that we are, and I think A Course in Miracles says, the arc of peace will be boarded in twos. In other words, we need each other in order to do this evolutionary breakthrough, because we can be When one of us forgets who we are, another can remember. And that we can partner in this journey of remembering together and making it more realistic for us to recognize, to realize, and to bring forth this truth of ours that has been buried, that we have forgotten because we have fallen asleep to who and what we truly are. And so waking up together is the antidote to this forgetfulness that has us feeling lost and separate and feeling like, you know, love is missing from our experience and life is against us. And all those notions are not rooted so much in the externals as they are in how we perceive. Yes? So how we perceive is rooted in how we see ourselves. Who we've taken ourselves to be is separate and a finite being that has a life that comes to an end. And that is not what we say every Sunday. We say there's only one presence and one power in the universe, God the good. And that oneness does not exclude us. If there's only one thing going on, then that must mean that we are equally a part of that one presence, that one power, that one life. Must be our nature, not just some lofty notion of a God up in the sky somewhere that we hope that we'll somehow merge with when we leave this plane. But that the possibility, that the promise, as Jesus said, is it's the Father's good pleasure to have given you the kingdom of God. It is within you, and it is here, and it is when. It's now. It's here, and it's now. So when we can bring ourselves to recognize and to realize who and what we truly are, then we can drop this false image, this false self that feels so vulnerable and so separate. When we realize what we are, then who we are not falls away. So I mentioned earlier that this idea of biological evolution seems to be on pause. And here's the reason why, or here's why it would seem. We've got to move the camera now, see that Bill jumps up. He's moving, look out. I don't know, maybe give him a break. Let me go off screen for a while. So this notion of we understand biological evolution, and I trust most people would agree that's been going on for a long time. And then we evolved to a point where we were so smart that we didn't really have to evolve anymore. So like, hey, I don't need fur. I'll just build a house, right? Or I'm cold. I don't need fur. I will just turn up the heat. In other words, we evolved this brain to the point where we could control the conditions of our environment so that we didn't have to do anything to take care of we didn't have to evolve our physical selves. We would just change the environment because we had the mastery over, sort of the dominion over our environment, because we were smart enough to do things to protect ourselves. And so we really, the idea of biological evolution is probably sort of, there's not going to be any more. So the evolution that we're going to experience is going to be the evolution of what? Consciousness, the evolution of consciousness. And that, and therein lies, that's the good news. Because since we don't have to be so concerned, hopefully this is true of most people, that we don't have to worry about protecting ourselves. You don't have that immediate concern. So our concerns have come to protecting what? Not our physical selves, but who we think we are, this person inside our head, right? Which needs a whole lot of maintenance, yeah? And it's that sort of concern for our well-being that drives our behavior. And puts us oftentimes, because we have this notion that we are a physical, finite self, that's the false understanding of who we are. But because we believe that way, then life has to be safe, right? Well, I have to create an environment, people have to treat me a certain way so I don't get my feelings hurt, or, you know, everything needs to sort of conform to make sure that this is taken care of. And I don't just mean the physical, but I mean, obviously, the psyche and our emotions and our feelings are all, you know, all of this, you know, when it's rooted in a very tender and sensitive notion of vulnerability, needs a whole lot of, for life to be a certain way, for us to be okay. Yes? Yes. So if we can make this leap in consciousness, in other words, if we can move out of this sense of separation, which is very doable, because that's who and what we truly are, when we can move out of that, then we can begin to experience what we've been looking for all along in trying to change life in order to conform to what would make us happy, peaceful, and feel loved. So here's the good news and the bad news, okay? So the good news is all of that's possible. The bad news is who you've taken yourself to be up until this point, your mistaken identity, will never wake up to the truth of your being, because it's a false premise. It's a false premise. Who you're not cannot become who you are. Does that make sense? You have to think about it for a minute. But if you take yourself to be a finite, time-bound self or person, then you are never going to experience being an infinite being. In other words, that's like, it's like oil and water. They're just, they don't mix. What is infinite knows nothing of what is finite. And what is finite knows nothing of what is infinite. They are mutually exclusive. Yeah? This is why we struggle. This is why this journey of spirituality and waking up and evolving and all the words we can think of in terms of becoming the fully, you know, realized child of God is so frustrating for us, is because we're taking this false notion of who we are and trying to, you know, scrub it and sand it and file it into this polished version of what we think we need to become in order to be spiritually enlightened. And we're working with the wrong medium. We're working with the wrong assumption. We're working with mistaken identity. We got to let it go. We have to let it go. And that is the hard part, because guess what? You and I have become conditioned to believe that we are this finite entity. Yes? But there's hope, because it's not true. It's not true. So I'm going to read a little bit from the book. And like I told you in the first week, this is loosely based on the book Birthing a Greater Reality by Robert Brummett. And it has a lot of these notions in there, but I've taken some liberties and I've gone off. But that is part of it. But I'm going to read from the book here. He says, "Each of us is the one dreaming that he or she is an individual personality. The purpose of life." Did you wonder what it is? What would you say it is after that first statement? If each of us is dreaming that we're an individual personality, what would be the purpose of life? Waking up. To awaken from that dream, to know ourselves as limited human beings living in a physical universe, and to simultaneously to know ourselves as unlimited and eternal. And I've heard this metaphor given before. It's like Mary falls asleep. So Mary lives in Squim, let's say. Mary lives in Squim, and she falls asleep, and she dreams that she's Jane, and she lives, and she's walking down the streets of Port Angeles. And in that recognition of herself as Jane, she forgets that she's sleeping. And she goes about her life in that dream state, you know, walking down the street, and she sees people and she has interactions and she does things, and life seems to be just what it is, what she perceives it to be. And she is never really going to know her source by searching in this dream world, trying to find her happiness. She's frustrated in this experience, and she thinks that she needs to just do more, maybe work on herself, go to another workshop, you know, more self-improvement, right? And so she does all these things, and she gets increasingly frustrated and even despondent and depressed at times, because she just can't seem to find this peace and happiness, which Mary enjoys. And so our advice for her is what? Stop trying to make the dream, improve the dream, and wake up to your Mary-ness. Because as Mary, she's connected with her wholeness, and this is, Mary is your Christ nature. All of us were created in the image and likeness of God, love, peace, and joy, and happiness, all those qualities which we think are about getting the dream to match our expectations and preferences and likes, and to stay away from our dislikes. In other words, to live a life of desire and aversion, which give me the things I like, bring those closer, and push away those things that I don't want. That desire and aversion is the only game for the ego, for the separate self. But for the enlightened, it's simply waking up. And that peace and that love and that happiness, which is a part of your infinite nature, is found in the recognition of who you are, not in the pursuit of objects or substances or situations or states. But that's all that the separate self can do. And we see it all the time. We're on a constant hunt for a person, a relationship, a substance, a situation that will give us that relief from the suffering that we endure in life when we feel separate from love and peace and joy. Yes? We're constantly trying to, you know, create this landscape of circumstances and conditions. All the while, the master says, call off the search. You don't need to change anything out here. I mean, you can, but don't expect that to be the lasting peace and fulfillment that you're looking for. Because the lasting peace and fulfillment that you're looking for is imbued in your true nature. And while you're thinking, you're taking yourself to be someone who's finite and apart from life, you will always be seeking, but not finding. And we know this story. And our opportunity, as we have now mastered, we can master our environment, we've now taken it too far, right? It was good in the beginning when we needed to build a shelter, when we needed to learn how to work with fire and these things to take care of our basic human survival. But because we became so good at it, we think, oh, I'll just change more out here. And so we've been seduced in this pattern of externalizing innovation for our well-being and forgotten that it's the internalizing, which is the awakening of consciousness to who and what we are, that will bring us the lasting peace and fulfillment and happiness that we're after. Does this make any sense? I think it makes good sense, but there's a part of us that says, well, what will that take? I mean, I've been on this journey for a long time. Anyone been on this journey for a long time? Oh my God. And I started late in life, and it's still been decades, you know? And I think, and this is where, and I hope you hear this in the right way, because some people hear this and it sounds depressing. Not my intention. I'm here to inspire you. But you have to hear this in a way. So the metaphor is a moth is drawn to the flame. But the only way that the moth can experience the flame is by flying into it, right? And so its desire to experience the flame requires that it what? That it dies. Anyone depressed so far? Now, there's a quote from the Apostle Paul. He says, I die daily. Right? What was he talking about? Yes, dying to who he's not. The false self. And it's like, you know, we've heard the example of the peeling layers away of an onion. It's really like that. Sometimes it's belief by belief, or thought by thought, or a notion by notion, that we begin to drop it away. Like when we begin to see that, wait a minute, that can't be who I am. And when we've had difficulty in life, that's sometimes when I have made my most leaps of understanding has been through adversity. Does anyone know that one? Because I've lost money, I've lost jobs, fortunately I've never lost a partner, which I know a lot of people have gone through that. But with the job and the money, those are two big identities, aren't they? I mean, you know, particularly your work. And when I lost a job, in ministry, I couldn't get back in. I quit a job, and it took me years to get back in the ministry. And I was doing all kinds of work that was really hard for me to do. I had 18 years of education, and I was working, handing out towels in a gym and making minimum wage. And what was happening to me initially was like I had flown into this flame, and I felt like who I was, you know, I had lost a big, huge chunk of my identity, because I identified myself with my work, with my career. And not just that, but that I was able to offer something to people. And now I couldn't do that anymore. I could say, would you like a towel at the gym? Would you like a towel? Have you heard of the Tao? Would you like a towel? Have a good workout. I mean, that was my jam for a time. And what it asked me to do was to say, are you what you do? Or is that something that can be changed? And then you essentially remain who you are. So when we have these experiences where we have these losses in life, they actually can be aids to our intention to awaken, because when we lose something that we have identified with, and we come out on the other side of it, and we realize that, yes, I've lost that job, but I'm still me. You know, you check in. You check in a different way. You don't check in as a description. I'm a minister, or I'm a lawyer, or I'm a baker, or I'm a candlestick maker, or whatever you do. You don't check in that way. You just go, how do I know that I am? And you do this sort of deep dive of your sense of being. Not being this or being that, just being itself. That's pure consciousness or pure awareness. That's your infinite nature. And guess what? I can lose a job. I could stop doing ministry. My wife could leave me. I hope not. I could lose all of my money. I hope not. But you know what? If I checked in with all of those events, which are losses and dramatic in the human sense, would it affect my being? No. How could it? You see, we tend to impose or map over our infinite nature with all these finite descriptors of who we are. We've done that our whole life. And so now we feel like life is very fragile, right? because I could lose money, I could lose my health, lots of things could happen. And if I have no sense of who I am that is beyond those temporary conditions of life, then I'm in trouble. But if I do have that sense, then I can let those things come and celebrate them when they come, and I can let them go and grieve them when they go, but it doesn't touch this. It doesn't touch who and what we are. This is good news. This is the good news and the great joy that Jesus and all of the masters who awakened to who and what they were knew and know. It can be no other way. And so as long as we have some sense of ourselves as infinite beings, and we can do that through these practices that you've been doing your whole life, which is really just asking the question, who am I really? And when your mind starts going in these thoughts about, oh, well, I'm a this, I'm a not that, I'm a husband, I'm a this, or who, just go, those are thoughts. You don't need your brain. You don't need your thoughts. You don't need your mind to tell you who you are, do you? If I ask you right now, do you exist? What would you have to do to answer that question? Do you have to think about it? Or do you just know it? Don't you just know that you are? That's who you are. That's who you are. You're neither a woman or a man or a Caucasian or an African American. Those all are added unto. Those are different manifestations of the infinite being that has taken form for a purpose of experiencing life in a body. But it's not the essence, it's not the core, it's not the truth, it's not what will exist after you're gone from this physical plane. Who you are and what you are is invulnerable. When we talk about spirit, we talk about spirit as being infinite and eternal. Isn't that right? And if you take yourself to be finite and time-bound, then your whole life is going to be about making sure you don't die, because that's the time-bound part, right? And you're going to spend all your other time, right, time that's left, is making sure that you don't have a lack in your life, that there's enough. Because if I don't consider myself, if I see myself as a finite being, then there's always going to be not enough of this, not enough of that. And we project that. We project that on each other, and we project it on the planet. We use up all the resources we can. We use up other people when we're noticing ourselves as feeling there's not enough. When we know ourselves to be infinite, then we can be what? Generous. We can give rather than take. We can treat the planet with the kind of love and generosity and compassion that comes from someone who doesn't feel like they are always needing something and they need the world to provide it. Yes? So this isn't just about me waking up so that I can be happier and have more peace, which I'm a big fan of. But if that happens, then can you see the repercussions it would have in the world? Because when I awaken to who and what I am, then I am a beneficent presence, aren't I? Then I'm someone who contributes to the well-being of the world and to the planet. Out of a sense of wholeness, then I am generous and I can give and I can share. And I'm not constantly needing you to be a certain way for me to be okay. Amen? Okay. Let's do a little meditation. How's the time? Do we have time for 3 more minutes? Okay, let's do it. I'll blame it on Tim. This is a video about who am I as a self. And it comes from a kind of a scientific perspective, but it's beyond that. Uh-oh. Maybe we won't watch it. Oh, there's Tim. What is the self? It's not going to work. Looks like you got the link right there. I see it. Yeah. Oh, well. It's not even YouTube there. Maybe just browse it and type in, what is the self? Can you do that? Can you just go to YouTube, search? There we go, just skip, yeah. There it is. There it is. There is a God, after all.
Most of us share strong intuition that our own self is an irreducible whole, that there must be some place in our brain where our perception and our sensation all get together and create thoughts and imagination and define our future. But neuroscience today is discovering that there is no single brain structure that embodies the self, and it's pointing to the fact that what is creating the sense of self is a complex mental neurological map allowing us to function as one single organism. Biology tells us that the human body is actually an ecosystem of trillions of bacteria, microbes, viruses, all with their evolutionary agenda. What is then the self, if what I call me is not one organism, but really trillions of different living entities? And look at the internet, this amazing web of connection in which each one of us is like a neuron, giving input and receiving information as much as viruses and bacteria are doing inside our body. Body and mind, our skin, can no longer be used to define the boundary of ourself. We are all connected with nature, with billions of people. Could it be this illusionary image of ourselves as separate beings that is keeping us in this perpetual state of anxiety, scarcity, fear, dissatisfaction, and leading us as a society at this very delicate point in evolution with the current ecological, economic, and social crisis? We need a new story, a new myth, to redefine our role as human in this interconnected universe. As the astronomer Carl Sagan said, we live on a small rock circling a star, which is one of 400 billion stars comprising our galaxy, which is only one of billions of galaxies comprising our universe, which is possibly not even the only universe out there. And that is a perspective on human life well worth pondering upon while we celebrate the mystery of the self.
So let's go within for a moment. And as we ponder that we are at this...
If you're Washington home...
We are at this place within us right now. This is our journey that has no distance. As we just come to notice that we exist, the I am that I am, that you are, is the one constant in this ever evolving, ever changing, dynamic experience of life. So let's affirm that right now. I am. Say that out loud. I am. God is, and I am. Together, God is, and I am. And in this knowing of I am, there is nothing missing. There is no need for there to be an object after I am, for us to know that we are, that we exist. And we exist knowingly as the conscious awareness that I am. Everything else is a limitation on this infinite being. And the limitations do not exist in truth. So we're here to remember. Nothing really to learn, perhaps more to let go of. So when we find ourselves adding an adjective to who we are, let's remember that those are just thoughts. And thoughts are not a reflection of reality. It's just a brain activity that has come from conditioning. But the unconditioned self, in your pure nature, there is simply being, being itself. It is that you know that you are, that is the portal to this awakening, which is the light of consciousness revealing itself as your nature. Peace, be still, and know that I am. Peace, be still, and know peace, be still. Peace, be. Let's sit in the silence of our own knowing. The I am that needs nothing for its peace, happiness, love, wholeness. Let's bathe in this knowing, in this unbounded reality, without limits, without form. Let us know that we are destined to awaken to who and what we truly are. It can be no other way. There is only one presence, one power, one reality. and it lives in us and through us, and as we are discovering, as us. So it is.